teams have traded places all season, and now on the very last day, the conference title could still be won by either Boston or Dagenham and Redbridge. Steve Evans' Pilgrims are in pole position, 3 points, and the title is theirs. Gary Hill's Daggers just have to win and hope Hayes can spoil the Boston party. The time has come for the talking to stop and the final act of this compelling drama to begin. It's a conference double-header title decider. We're at Church Road, Hayes, where table toppers Boston are the visitors. A win for them, and they are up. But if they slip up, the Daggers are waiting to pounce. Our cameras are trained on Dagenham and Redbridge for their game with Chester. So after 41 games, a combined 149 goals, it comes down to this. Two sets of fans, 90 minutes of football, but just one dream to reach the Football League. Welcome along. You feeling nervous yet? You should be. The Boston fans in front of me are certainly feeling it down here. Tony Cotty is my special guest alongside me here pitch side. And Tony, this is what they're all playing for.
That's what it's all about, Rob, isn't it? What a great incentive to get in that third division. Boston's destiny in their own hands today.
Certainly is. It's been a titanic struggle for the title. Let's just show you the conference table as it stands at the moment to put you in the picture. It's Boston who lead the way. It's all in their own hands at the moment. Boston, top of the table, courtesy of goal difference from Dagenham and Redbridge, both, as we mentioned, in action this afternoon. Then come Yeovil and Doncaster out of the picture at the bottom. Boston's opponents today, Hayes, I'm afraid to say, have already been relegated. The draw for Woking yesterday, consigning Hayes to the drop. As I say, it certainly has been a topsy-turvy seesaw race for the title in the conference this season, Tony Cotty. Even last weekend, it looked like it was tied up. Boston beating Farnborough by 4-0. And it looked at that stage as if Boston eclipsed the title, almost.
That's right, Rob, it did, yeah. I mean, with that win, it was a great win for them. And, of course, with Dagenham drawing as well, they really had the incentive was down to them, and they really felt that they was going to go on and win it quite easily. But of course then they had a little slip up on Tuesday. We see the goals here. This is the game against Farnborough, and the first goal coming up from Simon Rusk here. Ball's played across. That's a good finish from Simon Rusk.
They needed at the time, I guess, an angel to answer their prayers, and it happened, Tony.
Yeah, you got it spot on, Rob. I mean, that's a great free kick. Not sure about the goalkeeper, but it's a good finish into the bottom corner from Archangel there. It's the third goal coming up from Anthony Eldy. Long clearance for Paul Bastock. That's actually Darryl Clare's goal. That's a great finish there. Excellent finish there.
Anthony Eldy is not playing today. He's been calling a lot of interest from other clubs as well. That's a bit of a blow.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, he's only a young lad. He's 19 years of age, and they've got high hopes for him, but he's not playing today, so he could be a big blow.
Now, at that time, Dagenham were struggling against Scarborough, but it all flipped round again on Tuesday, didn't it?
That's right, Rob. I mean, it's been the story of the season, hasn't it? When it's looked like Boston are going to win it, then Dagenham come back. When it looked like Dagenham were going to win it, Boston came back. And credit to Dagenham, they stuck at it, and they got a good result at Woking. They needed it on Tuesday. And of course, while they was doing that, Boston were drawing at Morecambe. This is Dagenham's first goal coming up here for Mark Steen. I think it's a cross coming in there. There's a great header from Mark Steen. He's been doing that all his career. Brilliant finish from him.
All 5'6" of him. It's been notable for Dagenham and Redbridge. He was suspended for a few games and they took their foot off the pedal a little bit.
Well, you can't help but miss a player like that. That's Roscoe Desain getting sent off there for a second yellow. But when you lose a player of Mark Steen's calibre, it's going to affect any team, and it's the same for Boston. If you lose Darryl Clare, fortunately he's fit today, but if you lose a player like that, it's going to take its toll.
It's a cruel
own Scott Smith own goal there, yeah, but Dagenham, at this stage of the season, you take anything.
Okay, as I said then, it has been one of the features of this race for the conference title, the ups and downs of it. Greg Whelan has been speaking to both bosses and putting the course of the title.
When the two teams came face to face at Victoria Road, it was billed as the title decider.
Goodwin winning a header, and here's Vickers, yes!
Joy for Gary Hill, despair for Steve Evans. The Daggers went 7 points clear. But by then, the pressure on both managers had already begun to build.
I mean, they've all been smiling, but we ain't finished yet, Gary, I tell you now.
There's been main games played in both camps. I'm probably more guilty of wearing my heart on my sleeve and speaking how I feel and speaking the truth and things like that. And it's fair to say, it's probably upset Gary at times along the way.
In football and in life, that, you know, the only way you're going to get respect is by, you know, earning it the way you do things properly. And I'm afraid that, you know, I will not have that value towards him as an individual.
Boston marched through the rest of the month, winning 5 games out of 6.
I think we took great resolve out of losing at Dagenham. You know, I think whether they've done a lot before now, whether they've meant it as that, there was certainly some comments made in the tunnel area, which happens. But my lads have taken great resolve out of that, and they got a renewed focus.
But for Dagenham, March would become a month to forget.
We went up to Barnet, and we got a lesson. We got an education up at Barnet, big time. And, you know, that's football, that happens. It happens to the best at all levels. And it took us, you know, 2 or 3 games to get over that.
When Boston met Barnet on Good Friday, Jim Rodwell's header in the 3rd minute of stoppage time moved Steve Evans' side 5 points clear at the top.
And then we come into the Monday Sky game, which was, as far as I'm concerned, probably the biggest game I've had here at Victoria Road since being manager at Dagenham.
The Daggers won it, just thanks to substitute Steve McGavin.
Here's a chance now! Brilliant strike!
Relief for Gary Hill. But back came Boston again with another late, late show of their own.
I was frightened to listen to the radio, I must be honest. I turned the radio off, I turned the phone off. I knew that something had happened. I just couldn't believe it. I walked in and I heard that Boston got 2 goals in injury time.
Each time that when one of the sides has won a game, drawn or lost, it's been matched by the other side. And if that happens on Sunday, Boston United will be in the Football League.
We've come out of over the last 6 games now, and, you know, we've done superb. You know, we've done superb. I couldn't ask no more from the players and the supporters and the club to put us back in a position where we're going to the last game of the season on level points.
The pleasing thing about it going to the last day is it's what we do today. We don't need to look at what's happening in the East of London. It's what's happening in the West of London that's important.
If someone would have turned around and said to me at the start of the season that going into the last weekend of the season, you're going to be in the top two, whatever it may be, second on goal difference with a game to play, would you have took it? There's no doubt about it, I'd have pulled their arm off.
We've won more games than Dagenham. We've scored far more goals than Dagenham. We've conceded less goals than Dagenham. That tells you champions.
I look at Dover, I'm afraid got relegated, but they beat Boston. And I look at Stanley Bridge, who got relegated, and they beat Boston. And I'm looking at Hayes, who look like they're relegated, and I'm asking, please, beat Boston.
Oh, 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 it has been tight, hasn't it? Let's just emphasise again how this has switched around. March the 4th, and this is the way the table looked. Dagenham and Redbridge played Boston. Suddenly, they were 5 points clear, at the 7 points clear, I think, at the top of the table. And then April the 1st, there'd been a 12-point turnaround after Easter. And then April the 28th, here we are, final day of the season, all square. With Steve first. Steve, thanks very much for joining us. You're within touching distance now of the conference, quite literally. Here it is. I guess I've got to ask you, how are you feeling at this precise moment?
Well, I think obviously, like any manager in the city, you should not be nervous. Want to get the game underway. We'd have loved to have the game last Wednesday because it seems a long time since Tuesday. But, you know, you've just said there that we're in London, but it looks like we're in Boston and Lincolnshire. We've got a fabulous support here today, and this is what's about to happen to the third division clubs in terms of travelling support, should we get there.
You can't see April the 1st. It looks like you were the fall guys. It looks like, you know, it was all over, the 12-point turnaround. How difficult was it for you to pick the guys up and to get them for this run in?
Yes, you know, at that time we had that little bit of a bad spell that's caused us a problem, but, you know, we straightened that and we've done very well in April. It was hard going into the Morecambe game, you know, and we got a great result against Morecambe, and, you know, it was disappointing that afternoon again that, you know, Southport were 2-1 up in injury time, and all of a sudden Boston get two goals, all credit to them, and it was another kick. But, you know, we've hung in there, as you say, it's gone one way, gone the other, and I think it's been a great advert for the Conference League. And as I say, we can go out there today, hopefully get our 3 points, do our best, and then only hope. So whoever comes out of it, the players, supporters, and everybody connected at Dagenham and Redbridge, they've been superb this season.
Okay, Gary, thanks very much for the moment, Steve. It is tense, nervous times. Can you enjoy an afternoon like this?
I think I'll enjoy it at 10 to 5 with 3 up. You know, I've won the game for 3. No, this man on my left, Tony Cott, he's been in a lot bigger games like this, and I think this is the worst time for players and management. You know, we want the game underway. You know, the message to the players is we don't need to score in the first 15 minutes of the game, as long as we remain tight and solid and try and get the ball down as much as we can, because there's a bit of a wind here. But in saying that, it's not the best surface, so we just need to do the best we can.
Well, I think when you've got one of your best players or one of your best finishers, and undoubtedly he is, it's such a massive game, Rob, isn't it? You've got to have the players, and I think that most of the games in the season, you don't play players unless they're 100% fit. I think if Darryl Cleary's probably 75-80% fit, which he might well be today, you've got to play him. I mean, this is his goal against Hereford. We've seen many times before. It's a great finish, and that's the sort of things he can produce, and they'll just have to hope that he is bang on form with his fitness, and then he might be getting a few goals like that today.
Well, Steve, say to him then, just give me 60 minutes, give me as much as you can, and see what you can do.
Well, that might be enough, mightn't it? I mean, in that 60 minutes, you get a couple of goals, you can come off then, can't you? You can be substituted and come off as a hero. But again, another great strike there. And if your top player is anywhere near full fitness, you've got to play him in a game like this. This is a massive game for Boston.
It is a fascinating battle at the top. Now, Boston, as well as scoring a lot of goals, they've got the meanest defence, and possibly, I'd say, the meanest-looking goalkeeper in the conference. He's a frightening character. We are, of course, talking about Paul Bustock.
I just see him. He was warming up a little while ago just behind us, and I kept well clear of him. He does look a mean goalkeeper, doesn't he? But, I mean, we've seen them play many times this season, Rob, haven't we, Boston? And he's been outstanding every time he's played. He's a very good goalkeeper. Played 500 times for the club, and he's been a great servant. Signed 10 years ago. And I'm a big fan of him. I think of all the conference goalkeepers, he's well up there with the tops.
How good is it to have a vociferous goalkeeper behind you for the defence?
Well, I think if you look at someone like Peter Schmeichel, they're always talking, aren't they? And you need someone who's domineering behind the defence. And of course, as a goalkeeper, you always blame the defenders anyway. It's never your fault.
But he is certainly a colourful character. In that Boston goal, look out for him this afternoon. I guess Steve Evans and the like will be hoping that he's not that busy this afternoon in that Boston goal. So there he is, warming up ahead of this game here at Church Road. Boston, though, are in the driving seat going into this one. It's two sets of fans, two sets of dreams, I guess, but only one winner this afternoon.
Season ticket holder with Boston United, what does getting into the Football League mean to you?
Fantastic. I mean, to come to grounds like this, it just opens your eyes up to what facilities we've got. We've got league facilities, we've got a league team, and I think we'll hold our own there.
You can't fault Gary Hill. He's come here, he's spent next to nothing, and he's turned us from a nothing Ryman League team into a top of the table conference side. It's a great season, whatever happens.
But if it's 0-0 half time and Dagenham are winning, how are you going to feel then?
Not too happy.
We always thought that perhaps it would come down to the final day, and I'm glad it has. It's what football's all about.
Are you calm?
It certainly is what football's all about. These are the secret scenes that the fans hardly ever witness. This is the Dagenham and Redbridge dressing room in Victoria Road. And then just across town, this is Church Road. Two different roads, two different teams. We're here to see who will win the conference title. Kickoff is just around the corner. These are scenes. Dagenham and Redbridge just about to leave their dressing room there at Victoria Road. They play Chester this afternoon. They know they have to get a better result than this side. Boston are here at Church Road as they take on Hayes. If they're equal results, then it is Boston who will be going up to the Football League. The Boston fans have certainly turned out in force. I doubt there's a person left in Boston this afternoon because they're all down here at Church Road to witness Hayes against the table toppers, Boston. Tony Cotty's alongside me. Tony, which way is it going to go?
Well, I think their destiny's in their own hands, Boston. They've got about 5,000 fans here today. I expect them to win, Rob. I've already said I'm a Dagenham boy. I'd love to see them go through to the conference, but I really do feel it's going to be Boston's day.
OK, without further ado, let's join our commentary team, shall we? A conference winner in the past, it's Clive Walker, and today he's sitting alongside Kevin Keatings.
Thank you, Rob, and good afternoon, everyone. It's the biggest day in the history of Boston United Football Club, and is it to have a happy ending? Neither they nor Dagenham and Redbridge have provided a ruthless enough streak to see one another off as this fascinating race for league football has swung dramatically one way then the other in the past 2 months. But Boston's destiny rests firmly in their own hands. A win here against already relegated Hayes, and Steve Evans's side will be playing third division football for the first time next season. Well, it's a terrific atmosphere at Church Road this afternoon. A large proportion of Lincolnshire's come down to support these Boston United players, many of whom have tasted league football before. Darrell Clare included, their leading scorer, formerly with Grimsby Town. And a huge welcome for Boston as they're so close now to league football. Let's take a look at the two sides then. There is two changes to the Hayes side that started last week's 1-0 win at Hereford. Ryan Spencer and Paul Holmesgrove are injured, and in come Kenny Dyer and Kevin Warner. And Clive Walker, this is how they're going to line up.
Yeah, an interesting formation for Willie Wordsworth. They're playing a 3-4-3, and Dean Clark, the midfield player, who scores a lot of goals, so obviously want to get forward, but Jolly, Hodges and Warner, the front three, to cause problems.
Well, Steve Evans makes just one change from the Boston side that started the goalless draw at Morecambe last Tuesday, and that is Neil Tarrant coming in to attack to replace 19-year-old Anthony Elding, who drops down to the bench.
It's a basic four at the back, we feel, and Simon Weatherson really being the one that's going to support Clare and Tarrant, although Clare probably just playing off of Tarrant, Tarrant being the main striker.
Well, Darrell Clare, the leading scorer in the conference with 25 goals this season. How important his goals have been of late, of course, 11 in the last 13 for him. And he's reacted very well to non-league football. And this young man could be very important today. Will he deny Boston their league place? 20-year-old Nicky Ball on loan from Queen's Park Rangers. 3 clean sheets in his 6 games for Hayes so far.
A chance for him to impress as well, Kevin, Nicky Ball. When you come over from a club like you at Queen's Park Rangers, just down the road, he knows that people from QPR will probably be here watching him and monitoring his progress as well, and knowing that he's done well in recent games as well.
Kenny Dyer, wearing 8 for Hayes, is their captain at 37, a veteran of non-league football, and the captain for Boston today is number 4. Paul Ellender, who's in his first season at Boston, having signed from Scarborough, and he will play as an orthodox centre-back. He has been playing in an anchor midfield role for Boston at times this season, but this is the scene at Dagenham and Victoria Road, where Dagenham are at home to Chester City, and rest assured that whatever happens, all the drama as it happens, we will let you know what goes on in that other crucial match between Dagenham and Redbridge and Chester City. But our focus is firmly with Steve Evans's Boston United. Looked as though they might have been out of the title race, Clive, when they lost to Dagenham in front of our cameras back in early March, but there's been so many twists and turns in this amazing title race.
It's been fantastic, hasn't it? And what a climax to come to the final game of the season. I know in recent years the team at the last game has been confirmed as champions, but this is great, just, you know, one game away for both teams.
Well, it looked a tall task for Boston to be in this position, but they've only won 4 of their last 9 matches. Dagenham have won only 5 of their last 11. nerves have played a real part in this race for third division football. As for Hayes, well, their relegation confirmed yesterday. They were all but down anyway, but Woking's draw means that they cannot now get equal points with Woking, playing for a little bit of pride today. But a big game for Hayes in front of the cameras today, and a very, very young side. Steve Brand from Wirral will be our match official, and Daryl Clare and Peter Costello either side of the ball, about to get this match underway. Referee has checked with his two assistants, and it'll be Boston United to get this match started. It's a very dry, somewhat bumpy pitch. It's quite a windy day too in West London, and conditions not ideal. And likely more defeat figure and favour Hayes today than Boston. We'll see how it pans out. Now, plenty forward here for Hayes, and the shot driven in. That wasn't a bad try by Molesey. In comes the long throw now, and Ellender! And saved at his near post there by Nicky Ball. But the Boston captain there very nearly found an early goal for Boston to steady some nerves.
Yeah, some poor marking here by Hayes, but Ellender's good turn, isn't it? Looks like a forward when he's doing that. He played in midfield for part of the season.
Comes the corner kick. Oh, and Rodwell off the bar. Still it's in there for Boston. Weatherstone, goal! What a start for Boston! And the young man who's been scoring goals regularly for Boston this season, Simon Weatherstone, gets his 12th goal of the league campaign, and by far the most important. And they couldn't have asked for a better start, Boston. Steve Evans' side lead.
There's a good corner in as well, isn't it? And what a great header by Jim Rodwell there as it comes off the crossbar. It's not really cleared. And there's Simon Weatherstone with a good volley. And well, he buried that well, hit the target. That's all he can do from there. But the first header from Jim Rodwell, fantastic. And Nicky Ball just unable to get a good punch, good clearance on the ball. Great start for Boston.
Well, I think we saw some evidence there of why Hayes have had the worst record in the conference this season. That's the 79th goal they've conceded this season. Steve Evans already having a word with one of his substitutes.
Yeah, I think it's Simon Rusk, Kevin, who had that earlier challenge when the foot was left in there. Just felt someone's studs on the top of his boot.
So Simon Rusk makes an early exit, and Andy Lodge comes on.
Yeah, I think they switched Mark Angel. They brought him over onto the right hand side. Just change things around that way. It might be a little bit difficult for Mark Angel being totally left-footed. Obviously pleased though now they've gone the one goal up.
Ellender's free kick. Strong work here by Daryl Clare. Angel. In fact, it's Gould who's got the cross in. Oh, and the overhead kick. That was a really good effort. Terrific effort from Mark Angel. And a lot of athleticism there, and he nearly found the corner.
Wonderful skill, wasn't it? Rod's doing well to get the cross in. It's a good cross. An overhead kick by Mark Angel. Wow, that looks super. Love to have seen that go in the back of the net.
Vast army of fans who've travelled down from Lincolnshire. Colourful, noisy and happy at the moment. Oh, and Bustock's missed the flight of that. The corner whipped in there by Warner, and lucky to see it fly on the wind eventually. Force a corner here. Some sort of crossing in the end. Clark. Some good composure on the ball. Dean Clark flips it up towards Daly. He wins the header, and it's off the line by Rodwell. Well, great defending by Jim Rodwell. Lots of experience there. Daly denied.
I think again, you've got a question. Paul Bastock here came for the ball, got nowhere near it. Well, a very, very important clearance by Jim Rodwell.
And so far, so good for Boston United and their quest to reach the Football League. Simon Weatherstone's goal, well taken goal too, is the difference in terms of the first half here. And this is where it happened. Rodwell's header off the bar. Hayes couldn't clear. Weatherstone tucked it away beautifully. Half-time, Hayes 0, Boston 1.
expected the weather to play a part in this game, not the weather stone, and so early on as well.
No, that's right. I mean, you're going to be nervous in a game like this, Rob. What a great start for Boston. We see the corner coming in here. Brilliant header for Jim Rodwell, and Hayes just don't clear it. And it comes to Simon Weatherstone. It's a good first touch. That's the important one. And he cracks it into the back of the net. It's just what you need to settle the nerves down.
I was going to say, I mean, they must have gone out there feeling slightly a bit of anticipation, but that was perfect, wasn't it?
It was a perfect start, wasn't it? 4 minutes into the game, and you are nervous in this sort of situation, and to get that first goal is a great start for Boston.
Thank you. Come find me that umbrella, will you, Clive? I think we're going to need it during this second half. I'm just hoping that the wind doesn't pick up any more, otherwise we might be joining them at pitch level. If it gets any stronger, I felt our gantry here waver a couple of times, and there really are foul conditions as the second half prepares to get underway. No additional substitutions, by the way, to the one enforced upon Boston in the first half when Simon Rusk was injured early on to be replaced by Andy Lodge. And Simon Weatherstone's goal has Boston United still in the driving seat here, but amidst the driving wind and rain, it could all change. An early slip from the kickoff from Clark allows Clare to find Costello is running forward, looks for a penalty. Boston, they look strongly. Veerman claims for a penalty, and Steve Brand says no. And Steve Evans was racing along the touchline for a moment there. He was joining the claims for a penalty shout as Costello went down. Referee said no.
Well, when I saw this the first time, I didn't think it was Peter Costello. I think he's got the wrong side of the defender. He's done well, but I don't think it was a penalty, to be fair. And he's actually been sent off. He's been given the red card. And it must have been, obviously, for something he said to referee Steve Brand. Well, from what could have been a great start for Boston, it's turned a little bit sour.
Well, the whole dream could be turning sour here. Boston down to 10 men within a minute of the second half starting. Peter Costello felt sure that it was a penalty claim, and the referee Steve Brand showed him a second yellow. Remember, he was booked in the first half, and Costello has been sent off. Well, what will that do to the outcome of this match? The referee's not interested in allowing Ray Warburton to come on. Neil Tarrant is the player who's going to come off. Now, I think the referee is going to allow the switch. So Neil Tarrant is tactically withdrawn here. A striker comes off, and the vastly experienced defender, Ray Warburton, will come on.
It'll be interesting to see what they do now. Warburton, out and out centre-back.
Named the Conference Player of the Year last season with Rushden and Diamonds, Ray Warburton. And immediately he gets forward for the free kick, which is going to be played in by either Angel or Weatherstone. It's left to Mark Angel. It's good delivery as well. Free header and a goal! Oh, what an introduction! Ray Warburton with a header. And surely now, Boston United are on the way to the Football League for the first time in their history. And what a substitution from Steve Evans.
Well, I'm sure he'll take full credit for it, but I'll tell you what, this was a fantastic delivery by Mark Angel and Ray Warburton. And one big centre-back up for the free kick. There we see the ball coming in. Great delivery. We spoke about the marking from the Hayes players in the first half, and again, Ray Warburton, almost a free header, and he's not going to miss from there. What a turnaround. Could have had a penalty, player sent off, and now they've scored a good second goal.
Gould's played that ball downfield before his injury, which took a deflection, went out for the corner, taken by Angel, and Rodwell in there. And they have had a problem with these big, powerful, dominating centre-backs when they got forward for set pieces.
Like for like.
Now, here's Darrell Clare getting free for a moment. Here's a chance now for Clare. Oh, a really good try and a good save by Nicky Ball. But a really terrific effort we saw there in that moment, why he scored so many goals this conference season.
Yeah, he has. He's run well here, hasn't he? But again, poor play by Hayes. I just look at him running onto this ball, I just think, in my own mind, I was thinking, go on, hit it first time. And you just wonder if they'd have been at 0-0, whether he'd got that down and try and pass.
But it's the vastly superior goal difference that's really come to the aid of Boston. 84 goals now they've scored this conference season. This is one. Clark with a header. That's well fielded by Bastog. It just bounced slightly in front of him, but safe hands. There's been more action at Victoria Road, Dagenham, where Dagenham and Redbridge have scored a third goal. And Tim Cole, the defender, has got it to add to those two earlier goals of Mark Steen. It's going to be heartbreak for Dagenham and Redbridge today, I'm sure.
Well, that's fair play by Dagenham, though, is it? They've given it everything, right to the wire. And fair play to the manager and his team as well. I think that's excellent. They've gone out, did all they could. And as we're talking there, we say about Darryl Clough. I didn't think he'd quite last the 90 minutes, but he's done ever so well. Worked very, very hard.
Well, a terrific ovation for Darryl Clough. It was almost a standing ovation from the entire Boston United bench. As 19-year-old Anthony Elding comes on for the final few moments. This is Elding,
thoroughly deserved.
One or two of those Boston players, fans rather, might just get a souvenir of the match ball down there if the referee blows his whistle now, Steve Brand. The great scenes down at that end of the ground. It's a magnificent sight. And that's it. And who's going to make the dressing room? Not too many. Fantastic scenes here at Church Road. Boston United, for the first time in their history, and Steve Evans is absolutely mobbed, and the fans make a beeline for the Boston manager. And what a wonderful day this is for the Scot. And it's absolutely terrific. Well, one or two, including the man of the match, Jim Rodwell, with the headband there, have made the sanctity of the dressing room. But there are several Boston players still out here who've been absolutely swamped by the thousands of Boston fans who've made the journey down here today. It's been a journey well worthwhile. And for these players, Clive Walker, 42 league games, a hard slog, and now the release is evident.
Well, absolutely, that's the release that you can see, the relief that's in them there. And, well, that won't stop for a few more minutes, hours, days later.
And this is exactly how you felt 3 years ago at Cheltenham. You know exactly how they feel.
Absolutely. First of all, you're in the dressing room with your own players, and you're happy with your teammates, your fellow teammates, who've stuck by you throughout the season. And I would like to think that in a few minutes or whenever they can, they'll come out and address their fans, because they're all on the pitch now, the fans, and it's a lovely scene, and this is what they've been waiting for.
Well, a lot of these players are young, several of them have tasted league status before, and full credit to those players who've had to drop out of the league before. It's very easy to let your head drop, Clive, and your career to slip away, but full credit to these lads.
Yeah, absolutely. The ones that played there before will be so much looking forward to that. They are young, they're so much looking forward to going back there next season, and I'm sure the ones that they can take with them as well, that have played well in the conference, and now it's down to Steve Evans, maybe to strengthen his squad, maybe just to make his squad a little bit bigger perhaps, and just carry on the things that he's been doing this year, because he's done a wonderful job.
Well, they lost to Dagenham and Redbridge in front of our cameras in early March, and they trail Dagenham, who've beaten Chester City by 3-0 today. Dagenham and Gary Hill, their manager there, had a 7-point advantage at the top of the conference, and it looked then as if Dagenham and Redbridge would be winning the conference title. But again, this amazing title race took another twist, and the sign says it all. Boston United are the 2002 conference champions. It all came down to goal difference at the end, Clive, and those amazing 84 goals that Boston have scored.
Yeah, fantastic goal scoring rate, wasn't it? And I think a lot of praise will be hunted on Darryl Clough, obviously being a top goal scorer. But these guys can all take credit. They've all been involved. Even the players that came late in the season, like Ray Warburton, they're all part of the team. And well, as you can see, fantastic scenes.
A And I can certainly spare a thought at the moment for the Malkinson family, who for over 70 years were at the helm of Boston United Football Club. Ironic, really, that they're relinquishing their control over many decades at the end of this season. A new consortium based in North Nottinghamshire will be taking over Boston. But these fans, it's all been about what happened on the Church Road pitch today. And the early goal from Simon Weatherstone, and there, here's the champagne celebration starting in earnest here. Well, I'm not sure too much of it's been drunk at the moment, Clive.
Well, not yet, but I'm sure it will be later on. And who cares about the club suits, but great season. You know, I can feel for that. I've been there, it's lovely. It's great to win something, whether it be the league, whether it be a trophy, but they're thoroughly going to enjoy themselves today.
What a fabulous job the Malkinson family have done at Boston. There would be no Boston United Football Club without them. And we pay tribute to the job that family has done at this club down the years. Their greatest day in their history before today was the 1985 trophy final, when they were celebrating 50 years in existence. They reached Wembley, and over 12,000 fans went to Wembley and saw them defeated 2-1 by Wealdstone. But this has very much been Boston's day. And as we said earlier, Clive, scored the most goals, conceded the less, won the most number of games as well. And we'll be getting the trophy celebration for Boston. The Pilgrims have progressed to the Football League, and that's all coming next.
Welcome back. Yeah! Just to confirm that Boston are champions of the conference. Tony Cotty, chaotic scenes here, but lovely chaotic scenes.
Fantastic, Rob. You've got to say they deserve it, Boston. Unlucky Dagenham. Well done to Boston. Brilliant scenes, and aren't the fans enjoying it?
Oh, wonderful stuff. Let's go to the dressing room, shall we? Steve Evans is with Greg.
Steve Evans, Boston United are in the Football League. How does that feel?
I'll tell you how it feels. There's a set of lads here, are now going to do a lap of honour, because lap of honours are for the champion. Competition, and whoever wins it next year will need to deserve to win it, because we have.
Steve Evans, enjoy your day.
Wonderful stuff there from Steve Evans, wasn't it? You've got to spare a thought, I guess, at this moment for Dagenham Redbridge losing it on goal difference.
Well, of course you have, Rob, that's right, but you can look at certain results through the season, but the table never lies, and the winners are always the ones with the most points or the best goal difference, so you can't argue with that for Boston.
And the fans aren't bad either.
No, brilliant fans, and they look forward to the third division next season.
They're all crowded around the presentation area over there, ready to get their medals. There they are in the dressing room, ready to go out. Thank goodness he's put his shorts on, Tony.
It's a bit early for that, isn't it?
But here they are, they're on their way out. Congratulations to them in the end. Boston win it on goal differences. Wonderful climax to the season.
Oh, it's been a great season, Robbie. We've been covering it all season long. It's been some fantastic games involving both Boston and Dagenham. But like I say, at the end of the season, you look at who's the top of the league and you always deserve it. You can point to many, many pointers during the course of that season. But if you're number one at the end of it, good luck to whoever it is.
But as Kevin was saying in Coventry there, and as you said at the beginning of the programme, that they've got the meanest defence, they've scored the most goals, they've won the most matches.
That's right, they deserve it. All those statistics are backed up, and they've done the business today, Rob. They needed to come here, they needed to win. They could have come here and drawn and lost it, but they've done the right stuff. They won a good professional performance, and they fully deserve to pick that trophy up in a minute.
And as we've seen from Rushden and Diamonds this season, Cheltenham in seasons gone by, the teams that go up into the third division, they can more than hold their own, can't they?
Well, that's right, Kidderminster as well. There's been some good quality teams come up, and Rushden are in the playoffs this season. So, I mean, Boston can go up and know that they can hold their own next season.
I've got a feeling there's going to be a Lincolnshire party in this part of West London.
You're right, I can't see them making it back tonight. I've got a feeling they might be heading for the West End for a good night out, and they fully deserve it. The fans have been brilliant today, you've got to say that, and they fully deserve to have a nice party once his presentation's done.
It's almost like a horse racing meet, isn't it? They're all sort of around the winner's enclosure down there.
That's right, and the winners are Boston. And it's just been a...
Sorry, I didn't quite hear you, Tony.
The winners are Boston. Yeah. They've been giving me a bit of stick because I've been supporting Dagenham, but like I say, it's all about the winners. Good luck to Boston. I really hope they have a good season in the third division next year.
This is going to sound nice to the Boston fans around us. Here come the champions back out onto the pitch to get their presentation of their trophy. Winners one and all, Tony.
That's right, yeah. Paul Bastock, he was brilliant today. Jim Rodwell got the man of the match. He was outstanding. Daryl Clare, Simon Weatherstone, there's a good spine in that Boston team. And they'll all be looking forward to picking their medals up. There's nothing better than winning a trophy, and they'll really look forward to that.
Well, the heavens have just opened once again, but it's not going to rain on Boston's parade, is it? That's for sure.
I think it could snow, Rob, and they won't worry about it, the way the mood the fans are in.
And here they come. They're about to come out. The thumbs go up. Here come the champions. Boston United, led by the local boy. The keeper, he is bad, Pastock, isn't he? Out he comes, shorn of hair, not shorn of confidence, Tony.
Oh, that's right, 500 games for the club as well. That's brilliant, isn't it? It just shows if you're a good servant, 10 years at a club, and you look forward to days like this, and he must have been dreaming of that for many, many years. So good luck to Paul Pastock.
Not the 39 steps, but still just as crucial. Robin Bailey of the sponsors Nationwide just about to give out the trophy up here. They're going to get their medals first. These are all, you've had a look at one of these before the game kicked off. They're nice, aren't
they? Yeah, they are nice medals. It's a nice trophy, nice medals. I think they're new ones for this season. And they'll have pride of place on the mantelpiece for all the players. And they all fully deserve it today.
They turned professional at the beginning of the season. Was that the key for you for their championship tilt?
Well, I think it's always a gamble, Rob, isn't it? Going professional in the conference. But you've got to say it's paid off. And they put their money where their mouth is. They've paid good money for the players. They've splashed out for players as well. So they fully deserve all the credit they're getting now and all the credit they're going to get in the papers in the morning.
Flag just says it all. Simple, isn't it? One word. Champions.
Yeah, champions. And Daryl Clare, I mean, he's been superb. And he will be scoring goals next season in the third division, there's no doubt about that.
He is the top scorer in the conference. He came into it carrying a calf injury, and after the sending off, he had to play that lone role up front, and he did well in the game, didn't he?
If he was injured, you certainly didn't notice it, did you? He was outstanding, and it's the hardest position in the world to play up front on your own. But once the sending off happened, Daryl Clare led the line fantastically well, and he's had a great game today and a superb season.
Fans loving it, Bastock loving it as well. You can't miss him, can you? That's for sure. Nice of them holding their medals there. And here he comes. Any moment now, Steve Evans will be coming out. Played with Celtic boys alongside David Moyes. Different career paths, perhaps, but they're both doing well in their managerial careers.
Well, it's brilliant for Steve Evans, isn't it? I mean, it's been a great battle. There's been a lot of talk going on between Steve Evans and Gary Hill. They've been winding each other up, not dissimilar to Arsene Wenger and Alex Ferguson, but you can see what it means to him. And he's had a brilliant season. It must be great as a manager to lead your team to a trophy. And I think Steve fully deserves that. Look how much he's enjoying it.
He's played under Alan McLeod, Craig Brown. He would have taken those things into his career as well, wouldn't he?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you learn under all the managers and people you play with, and he'll take that into his job, and he'll be really looking forward to the challenge of third division football.
So here it is, Boston, our champions of the conference in the year 2000. Yeah! scenes, the top of the non-league pyramid, hence the trophy, Tony.
That's right, top of the pyramid. And I'll keep repeating myself, but they fully deserve it, Rob. What you put into football, you get back out, and they fully deserve to be holding that trophy.
So the scenes here at Church Road, I reckon they're going to go on for quite some time, whether on the pitch or in the surrounds here in Hayes. A little bit of Lincolnshire. Here he goes, Steve. He lifts a big trophy, does the big man. And you can see the smile written all over his face, can't you?
Yeah, he's a real character, isn't he? Look how much he's enjoying it. Fantastic. I'm really pleased for Steve.
After that defeat at Dagenham, when they went down there and a few things went on that he was unhappy about, it must have been difficult to lift his players. He's done such a good job.
That's right. I think, what was it, 6 or 7 points they went behind. And when you go behind, they had the game in hand, which was crucial. But you've got to raise the players. They must have been so disappointed after losing that game at Dagenham. And then, of course, Dagenham doing their lap of honour and everything. It must have wound up the players. But they've responded to that. That's what football's all about, Rob. You get a kick in the teeth and you've got to pick yourself up off the ground. And credit to Boston, they've done that.
You've had a close look at them. How many of these players do you think can go on in the Football League? Will they need to get some more in, or are they looking pretty well equipped to you?
Well, I mean, I'm sure Steve will be looking to bring some players in, because the best time to bring players into a club is when you've actually won something, because you can attract the players and you can say, come and play for us, we're a third division club.
Daryl, look at all of this. Tell me how it feels.
Well, it's the proudest day of my life.
Proudest day of my life by far. When we rolled up at 2:30, there was 2,000 people. Goosebumps, and if that didn't inspire us, nothing ever would.
You've been in league football before, Daryl, and now you're back.
Well, some of our older players, they've never been there, they don't know what it's like, but for them it means everything, it means the world to them.
And the added bonus for you personally, you finished top scorer in the conference.
Yeah, well I came to Boston, it was a slight gamble, it's all paid off now, it's been worthwhile.
Boston, how much does all this mean to you?
As much as it does to the EG supporters have wanted it, I feel like a supporter. Finally, I've got the luxury of playing. I do feel sorry for Dagenham, but end of the day, only one team can go up. And it all came down to the last game, and I think we held our nerve against in a difficult condition. And we've done it. We've done it for Boston. And we've done it for Stevie Evans and my father-in-law and everyone. I'm just over the moon with what's going on. I'd just like to thank all my family, because I have been a nightmare since the Hereford game. I've been jittery and they've got me through it. Thanks very much. And a clean sheet on Sky for once.
10 years you've been in this football club. This was always the ambition, wasn't it?
Oh, definitely. I came to Boston. The manager told me we was going to go into Football League. It would never panned out that way. We got relegated. To get into Football League now, near the end of my career, it's what a wonderful thing.
Well done. Well done, mate. Well done, mate.
Thank you very much, mate.
I think he's happy. He could do with one of these on his head, couldn't he? Thanks very much. It's lovely. I think we've got some semblance of normality here.
I thought your hair looked better with that wig on.
Oh, no, it did. At least I had some, I think. Anyway, if you're just joining us, it's absolute chaos, but fun chaos. We're here at Church Road. Boston have been promoted to the third division. They are conference champions. Ray Warburton, when he came on.
Fantastic stuff. Well, that's right. I mean, you talk about inspired substitute. There can't have been too many better ones than this. Ray Warburton, look in there, look, they've said to him, go straight up there, get yourself in the box. We've got a free kick, see if you can get us a goal. You always say, you never believe that they're going to do it. And then the cross comes in for Mark Angel. There's Warburton, first touch. What about that for a substitution? Credit to Steve Evans. Like you say, they was forced into it by the sending off, Rob. But that's a brilliant, brilliant header from Ray Warburton there.
Tell me how that feels and how important was that second goal.
Very pleased with you, aren't they?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, just massive relief. I think 2-0, you've got chance to defend that. 1-0 is always a chance and they might sneak back in.
How tense were things for you until you got that second goal?
I didn't have a chance because I'd only just come on, so it was a matter of, it could have been a better start for me, to be honest.
How much credit then to the manager for an inspired substitution?
Well, I don't think he was inspired. Well, fair play. It was just, I think, the timing and a bit of luck, to be fair.
How does it feel to be in the Football League?
Fantastic.
Thanks very much indeed. All the best.